Hello, malty, modern, multimedia, malt mass mates. No, oh, that's a good one, that. I'm going to do that. I'm going to mention that malt mention again, because that's an intelligent, short malt mention. It's not too long-winded. I prefer them that way. Hello, malty, modern, multimedia, malt mates. I tell you what, Stuart Blandford. That's a great malt mention, Stuart. Thank you very much. This is Ralfy Review 854 Extras. It's the extras, malt mates. I started doing the extras about a year ago because reviewing two whiskies a week was, it was a bit much. I mean, I could do it, but I was kept, bottles were piling up because I never ever finish what I review. Very rarely, because I'd be an alcoholic if I did, and I don't want to be. I tried it once, but I didn't have the commitment to sustain it and be successful, and I'm mighty glad that was the case. I just don't have the constitution to tolerate it. But it's actually been a blessing because over the years, it's allowed me to connect with spirits all around the world and go on these different journeys, starting in Scotland, but going to other places and discovering them in smell and taste. And it's been a fascinating journey, and it's never really been interrupted with the fact that I had to go to a clinic and dry out and register as an alcoholic. But if you're in that position, there's no middle distance, there's no middle ground. Either you can drink or you can't drink. And if you can drink, you've got to control it. You just have to be able to control it, because if you can't, you just don't do it. I'm very fortunate. I'm a relatively slow drinker, always have been. And as a result of slowing things down, I've just had more connectivity with the flavours that I have found in different bottlings. And I was in a supermarket many years ago, Sainsbury's it was called, in Glasgow. And I noticed that they had their own bottling of Irish whiskey. This was it. And what struck me was how honest the labelling was. On all credit to supermarkets, they know how to do a simple label. It was a lovely style, simple green bottle, screw top, black, simple green and cream label, a little bit of gold detail. Very classy, very stylish. I really liked it. And on the back, they've got practical information in the bottle. I think I bought this about 2006. They actually had a reference number. This reference number printed in the back of the label, I'll read it out to you in case you're interested. L10026-11. Bottled at 40%. It's got no age statement. Simply says single malt Irish whiskey. So I did my research on it, and I discovered it came from Cooley Distillery. Now, Irish whiskey, not that long ago, was Bushmills in the north, Middleton in the south, and Tullamore Dew somewhere in the middle, but nobody knew about it. And that was it. But when you went on and did your research online, you found the likes of Kilbeggan and places that, old, really old distilleries that are just kind of hanging in there, or are just been mothballed or closed down completely. And at that point, you discovered that one, not that long ago, we're talking about 100 years ago, well, more now, because Prohibition really knocked Irish whiskey in the head big time. But there's over 200 distilleries, and they're all producing different whiskey. And back in the old days, it was Irish whiskey that had the reputation for quality, not Scotch whiskey. And it's well recorded and documented that in Campbelltown, simply because of their proximity for taking the whiskey across to America, and the fact that there's a massive big coal seam down in the Mull of Kintyre, so they had fuel handy for firing the boilers and keeping the stills hot. This was, at one point, it wasn't just Springbank and Glen Scotia and Glengyle Distillery in Campbelltown. There was about 23 distilleries there, churning out new make spirit, bottling it up and sending it over to the US as fast as they could. And a lot of it was rubbish. Just saying. And Irish whiskey was better thought of. And one of the reasons, because it was triple distilled, not double distilled and fired through and hot liquor coming out, on a conveyor belt. Irish whiskey being triple distilled and done a little bit slower had more finesse to it. And it was very popular in the US where access to liquor was, it tended to be, there was some good bourbons, but a lot of it was really young stuff, and rye was, for many palates, simply too flavoursome. So in fact, it was Irish whiskey who had to have a drop of rye put in it, and it was considered, that was considered a whiskey and rye, as well as bourbon and rye. And of course, you still find that there are places in the US, even now, where Jameson's is the main spirit of choice behind the bar. It really depends on your origins of the population that are now in the communities. But when I opened the bottle of this, and it was £14 a bottle, £14 a bottle, so it was not expensive. Do you know, it really blew my socks off. I went straight back to that supermarket and I bought 6 bottles of this. It was a whiskey I had never tasted before. It was green flavoured, menthol and some eucalyptus and mint and complex mint and wintergreen and soft fennels and anise and cardamom and more mint. It was nothing like a Scotch whiskey. Nothing. It was a revelation. And it came from Cooley Distillery. Now, Cooley Distillery just basically popped up by accident in a place called Dundalk, which is very near the borders between Northern Ireland and Ireland, on the Irish Sea. Very coastal distillery, actually. And it was originally, the owners who were producing potatoes needed to do something with the potatoes. They were going to turn the potato, surplus potato, all the blotchy potatoes and misshapes that the modern consumer, they want perfectly round potatoes that look like a fresh laying egg because they're fussy and immature. And they don't want soil in the potatoes. Oh, heaven forbid, they'll get soil in my potato. I tell you what, you just give them a wee rub with a cloth, soil the lot, whatever, just bang it in. Eat your potato peelings. Never eat the potato without the potato peelings, because there's vitamins in the potato peelings.
Yeah.
Very nutritious. So they were turning surplus unwanted potatoes into spirit. And I think that what they, because of inexperience, they just went with what they got out the still, and what they got was something was absolutely fabulous. It was the most singular identity, which really jumped out to whiskey drinkers for a very simple reason. Over recent years, the character of Jameson's and Bushmills has lessened, and you only notice this when you go back and find a bottle of Bushmills or Jameson's from about 20 years ago or even older, and you taste a far richer spirit from both these distilleries than you're tasting now. You see, the thing about corporate ownership in both Bushmills and Middleton Distillery are corporate owned, is corporations have a way of working which means they want their product, whatever the cost, to appeal to as big a mass of consumers globally as possible. And the quickest way to do that is to sanitize the flavor. Now, for your average whiskey drinker, they're going to be cool with it, because they're buying the brand, they're not buying the contents of the bottle. They're buying the label. Still the case today, except for the folk that come along and watch a ralfy review. So this distillery appeared, and it was just all about the flavor, and I loved it. I went out and I bought some bottles of Kilbeggan, I think it was. Not quite sure now. It was a horse racing Tyrconnell thing. I got there. Tyrconnell whiskey, single malts, they weren't the same as this. They were over-matured. They were sanitized. They were, and I understand why they did it, because there's not that many people would go for this flavouring that time ago. I mean, I could, because I'm open-minded and a complete geek. But thereafter, another one that I came across was this, Green Spot. And this is essentially a version of Jameson's. This is the Jameson's Crested 10. When you get the crested thing, it basically, it means the support still components higher. I do not buy standard Jameson's, and I don't review it for you because it's too bland for my palate. Simple as that. But this, bring the bottle out, is a whole different creature. You'll notice, by the way, how similar they are in presentation. Green bottles, screw tops, longer labels, cream colours, green writing. Well, not so much here in the Crested 10. But these bottles at that point, not so long ago, there was a conservative presentation of Irish whiskey, and it wasn't really interrupted until the likes of Redbreast appeared. Certainly with Bushmills, you've got that square bottle, which is always a weaker bottle, and it tends to be clear glass. But when you're looking at the Irish whiskey shelves, you see this. It's slightly cliched, but it actually works. And all these three whiskies, I'm not reviewing them, but I can tell you right now, they're all well worthwhile. One question you're going to ask me is, hey, Ralphie, has the Green Spot changed much? Not that much. It has changed slightly, but not that much. I had some Green Spot recently from when I was visiting a friend, and it was just slightly fresher. But the thing is, when you've got pot still whiskey, now this isn't pot still whiskey, this is double distilled malt. But with this pot still whiskey, the younger the better. There comes a critical point. I'd say that between 5 and 9 years old is probably the best time, with some proactive but not overly assertive cask influence. It's really just tempering the spirit. I mean, if you get an opportunity at these distilleries to taste the new make spirit, the white claret, fresh out of the still, jump at the chance. Possibly it's the finest whiskey you're going to taste that day. Except it's spirits, not whiskey. But you knew that. So, Crested 10, great wee dram, absolutely fantastic. But, excuse me, I should go and move these out the way a little bit, because I need to scrunch the bottles up to let more bottles in. This gives you a window into someone's Irish whiskey collection. You'll notice these are standard bottles. They're not the collectible, they're not wooden boxed Middleton's exceptional rare. I've got a bottle of that open, but I'm not hugely impressed with it. Best Bushmills out there. The problem is, you need to buy at auction. This is a 1990s Bushmill Black Bush. Black Bush, basically, it's Bushmills matured in sherry casks. Older bottlings, take my word for it, are far superior to what is being bottled now. The quality of the casks is just not there anymore. And it really, really shows. And many Bushmill fans are quite disappointed. They yearn for the days when, back in the days when you get the 23-year-old at an affordable price, and you get really, really good qualities of what is essentially a very sweet whiskey. The way it's presented and packaged. It doesn't have to be, because when you get the dry, bittered versions that sometimes appear from earlier bottlings of Napoleon Castle, they're wonderful, wonderful whiskies. Here's one that I've just reviewed, the Yellow Spot. So here's the Red Spot. You can see already the colour's a bit suspicious, as if to say, well, it's an older whiskey, we're asking a higher price, we better make it look darker so it looks better. We'll wait and see, but I bought this simply because I wanted an opportunity to try it comprehensively before the prices rocket up even further. This is over £100 a bottle, folks. So what I want to do is review this beside the yellow spot and tell you if this is worthwhile. This is the red spot. I'll put it around there. Finally, here's a whiskey I bought out of curiosity. This is Drumshambo from Shed Distillery. Immediately you can see there's much more adventurousness going into packaging and presentation of Irish whiskey. This is a very good example of a newfound confidence in Ireland, which over the last 5 years, distilleries have been very much finding their feet and getting on with it despite the lack of experience available in the industry because there's been too few distilleries around. So Irish distillers have had to learn very, very quickly and literally learn on their feet and make mistakes and learn fast from these mistakes because of the cost of them. I think that many are heading in the right direction. Some, in my opinion, are floundering a wee bit. Any Irish distiller, the worst mistake they can make is make clean, sanitised, fresh, overly distilled spirit with too many cliches in the presentation. You find you'll capture the tourist market with that when it's seasonal. But apart from that, no. It's finding the flavour and experimenting with the flavour. And this is why I'm mentioning this bottle. I'm not reviewing it because it's not got an age statement on it. But it's young, immature. It is immature. What does it say? Single pot still Irish whiskey. Single pot still incorporating malted and unmalted barley, but, and they state it in the label, also incorporating oats. Now, they're using a particular variety of oats, and you get very fine quality oats from Ireland, which are less porridgey and easier to work with, but I think probably they still had a bit of trouble with the hubble bubbles in the wash in the washback. But they're using, and I'll just tell you, Irish malted barley and Irish barra. It's barra oats. It's bottled again at 43%, not 40%, thank goodness. 43%. Even better at 46%, but hey, they're still learning. And there's not many people realise, when it comes to Irish whiskey, they are not restricted, limited, and essentially hobbled. Yeah, hobbled like Scotch whiskey in having to only use oak casks. Irish distillers can use wood casks from many varieties of tree, including chestnut and cherry, and as a result of which, the distinctiveness that these cask wood types impart on the whiskey is going to take it in new directions. Another thing which you've already pointed out here with this Drumshambo is that Irish distillers are not restricted to using barley, unlike Scotch whiskey distillers who can only use barley in single malt whiskey. Although there is some debate about a certain period of history where an alternative to, just shortly after the war actually, an alternative to barley was used. But that doesn't get mentioned about because it's a bit of mythology. But this is really, when you have a situation, Scotch whiskey, where the restrictions are really quite rigorous, you can only use oak wood. You can only source oak wood. And it doesn't matter the quality of the oak wood, you've got to use it anyway. This is creating difficulties for Scotch whiskey distillers. And Irish distillers can get around that because they can say, right, we're going to reassemble an old oak cask, but we're going to put in a few chestnut staves. We're going to use intermix with other woods. We can use inner staves. Not a problem. And look at a fantastic result we're getting because sensitive use of wood in maturation, particularly on lighter styles of whiskies, are more dramatic. and they work so well. And one of the secrets of success is to have that wood influence and then remove the wood influence and then let the contents marry together and settle. This is the advantage of inner staves, as I've shown to Patreon pals with my little cask project. I would conclude by saying that Irish whiskey, corn whiskey called Green Ore, there's a corn whiskey being produced, fantastic stuff, very, very good. Irish whiskey could be made with a mixed mash bill, no problem. We're going to see that at some point. It's genuinely exciting. And I know that the Irish Distillers Association communicated with the Scotch Distillers Association a number of years ago, asking for pointers or advice. And frankly, they were met with a civil and polite brush off, in my opinion. And I just want to reassure Irish distillers, just do what you're doing. Be confident in yourself. Go for it. Find these flavours. Showcase these flavours. Go out and buy a bottle of Yellow Spot. Go out and buy a bottle of Connemara. Go out and buy a bottle of Redbush 12-year-old cask strength. Explore it. Really explore it and saying, we're not going to try and reproduce this. But what can we do where we are to create something the equal to this of a different flavour? Then, once you've done that, never bottle at 40%. Leave that to Scotch whiskey. Let them bottle at 40%. 46%, unchill filtered, natural colour. Go for it. Take the advantage. Let the Scotch distillers catch up, because they've been dragging their heels, in my opinion. But I'm not here for a rant. Oh, lovely. Excuse me. I'm not going to have all the bottles at once, because that would be risky. Malt mates, it's been a pleasure and a privilege and a joy. Thank you very much for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this, and we'll see you soon for Ralfy Review 855, where I'll be reviewing a rum. Rum-ti-tum-tum, you landlubbers.